We are now at chapter 1, page 37. Apollo and Dionysius. Quote, "He, man, is no longer an artist. He has become a work of art." Friedrich Nietzsche. The importance of the works of Nietzsche on 20th century thinking in general and postmodernism in particular can hardly be overstated. Many of the greatest minds, especially of 20th century Europe, have been deeply influenced by Nietzsche, and the books published on him and his thoughts by now span whole libraries. Early receptions include the book by his contemporary Lou Salome, with whom Nietzsche shared an entirely complicated relationship, as well as the published seminaries given by Martin Heidegger and Carl Gustav Jung on Nietzsche, to name only three of the more important examples. Later on in the 20th century, the works of many prominent proponents of postmodernism refer to Nietzsche. Some of those either devoted entire books on Nietzsche's thoughts, like Gilles Deleuze or Gianni Vattimo, or have been influenced by his thinking, like Wolfgang Schirmacher, Jean Baudrillard, Jean-François Lyotard, or Michel Foucault. Being aware of the overwhelming vastness of this literature, the aim of this introductory chapter is not to so much chart the course of Nietzsche's influence throughout the 20th century, but to focus on certain elements of his thinking which pave the way for postmodernism and are of relevance for the project of an art of the transpersonal self, as it will emerge through the following pages and chapters. To be more concise, the aim of this introductory chapter is to work out the first part of an interpretive frame, which shall serve as the theoretically guiding grid for the whole book. The second part of this frame will be provided in the subsequent chapter, when I will be retaking from a Foucauldian point of view some of the topics dealt with now under a Nietzschean light. Both together will constitute the frame from which one can approach the main topic, the art of the transpersonal self. This first chapter thus serves several purposes. First, I will approximate with Nietzsche a certain style of living as practiced by the ancient pre-Socratic Greeks. I will show how the Nietzschean understanding of the Greek style of living is derived from the interplay of two forces, the Apollonian and the Dionysian. Secondly, it will be established how this interplay was to be fatally disrupted, and thirdly, some possible consequences of the subsequent hegemony of Apollo and suppression of the Dionysian will be approached. Out of this historical overview, the interplay of the Apollonian and Dionysian will be isolated as entry point for a theoretical discussion on a current art of the self. Ultimately, it will become necessary to supersede this, like any theoretical frame, at the point at which theory fades. However, in order to be able to twist, revendin, our theoretical foundations, we need to first make explicit what they are, and this will be the topic of chapter 1 and 2. 1.1. Friedrich Nietzsche and the birth of Greek tragedy. When Friedrich Nietzsche published The Birth of Greek Tragedy as his first book in 1872, there might have been a myriad of purposes on his mind. Some of them, indeed, are fairly obvious and have been much discussed. Amongst those evident reasons, one can safely rate his hopes for a rejuvenation of Europe through Germany, a hope which he was very soon to give up on. And another obvious motive in this book was to give expression to his admiration of Wagner, for which he would in the preface to a later edition also criticize himself harshly. Yet despite his ostentatious praise for Wagner and misguided hopes for a Germanic revival, this book is also Nietzsche's coming of age. Once it is freed from those obvious flaws, obstructing the casual reader's view, then one will find that many of the brilliant insights which Nietzsche later on develops in a form that is, to use his own expression from the new preface, perhaps less saccharine, are already contained in this early work. In the words of Gilles Deleuze, it is indeed the birth of Greek tragedy where the real Nietzsche breaks through from behind the masks of Wagner and Schopenhauer. What thus remains is a work outstanding for its originality, daring to radically break with accepted academic standards, and containing key insights which, more than a century later, postmodernity is still drawing on today. Commentators have remarked that this first book of Nietzsche is, indeed, hard to accept under the premises of modern science. In it, the author shows himself to be not overtly concerned with historical accuracy and scientific proof for the account he gives. Yet, it can be argued that the preoccupation with ancient Greece for Nietzsche was more a vehicle via which a criticism could be made about the living conditions he saw during his time and show how they might be changed. At this point, I would once more like to call to attention the argument proposed by Vattimo in the discussion on the state of the art, that the birth of Greek tragedy is also, and perhaps mainly, a critique of contemporary culture and a program to revitalize it. There are two things of interest for what is at stake here, which unite Nietzsche's first work with many of his later writings. The birth of Greek tragedy is, like also his later gay science, a lifestyle book. They both deal with the question of a certain style of living, understood as a way of conceiving oneself and of giving one's life a distinct shape. However, while the gay science is a work of a more prospective kind, and so deals with Nietzsche's reflections on his own way of living and with the ways of living he saw during his time or wished to see coming or bring about in the future, the birth of Greek tragedy deals with a way of living that at Nietzsche's time was long dead and gone. Nietzsche so analyses the cosmovisions of the ancient Greeks, and he chooses a rather peculiar approach at that, for he looks at Greek lifestyle through the lens and focus of Greek tragedy and art form. Nietzsche deals with the crucial time span in Greek history in which the realm of art tragedy withered and came to be replaced with new Attic comedy. Simultaneously, this is also the period in which philosophy started to appear on the scene in its modern form, with the thinking of Socrates and Plato. What Nietzsche suggests is that this shift is more than a coincidental simultaneity between a change in the realm of arts, replacement of tragedy by Attic comedy, and in the realm of thought, a new system of thinking which arises with Plato. He contends that together with those two occurrences, the whole way of Greek living and perceiving the world undergoes a fundamental change and break. This in turn brings us to the birth of tragedy's crucial theme, which would stay with Nietzsche for most of his creative life, the two principles of the Apollonian and Dionysian. It is precisely the change in the relation between those two principles and the different ways in which they are portrayed, which, in Nietzsche, connect the question of Socratic-Platonic philosophy with the question of the Greek tragedy and ultimately the way of living. At this point, we need to take a closer look in order to discern how exactly one of those three elements, the conception and shifting perception of the Dionysian Apollonian relation, traverses the two other elements, the life and death of tragedy in the realm of arts, and the onset of Socratic Platonic thought. With Wolfgang Dietrich, I will argue that what ultimately emerges from this shift is a changed cosmovision, a changed perception of self, society, nature, and universe, and how those relate to each other. Following the birth of Greek tragedy in the chronology of its account, let us begin with an approach to the realm of the arts. This necessitates a glance at the Greek world of divinities. The ancient Greeks venerated both Apollo and Dionysus as god of the arts, and, as Wolfgang Dietrich puts it, they honored both gods in kind. On the one hand, there is a deity of formal beauty, aesthetics, and style, or, as Dietrich remarked, the god of form, Apollo. On the other hand, one encounters the wild revelries of the cult of the Dionysian, a god of the orgiastic, and once more with Dietrich, the god of content. If the formalistic elements of the Apollonian reach its epitome in the clear and sublime Greek architecture, it was the non-imaginistic heart of music and the energetic vibrations it produced that was deemed to be the expression of the Dionysian. Manifested in those two gods, therefore, were two principles, two concepts. Those concepts, in turn, cannot so much be perceived as opposed, but on the contrary, as mutually conditioning each other in the form of a codependence and dynamic interrelation. Contrary to appearances, there is so no dialectics in the Apollonian and Dionysian, but a reciprocal call and co-determining connection. For the Greeks, Apollo could not exist without Dionysius, and vice versa. What is hidden in those metaphors is a fundamental perception about life and how to live it. Life for the ancient Greeks in this pre-Socratic period only becomes possible in the interplay of those two, in the simultaneous acknowledgement of both Dionysian and Apollonian elements. This is how the Apollonian-Dionysian connects the world of the arts to the concretely lived world of the Greeks, a world in which it is deemed necessary to give an individual life a certain shape. The image of a struggle between Apollo and Dionysius, which arises on first sight in Nietzsche's account, points to the conflictive nature of the interplay and to the shifting relation between the two principles. Apollo and Dionysius were not always and at each time evenly matched and equally balanced. The Nietzschean picture, the rise of Greek society, is thus one in which, firstly, the two principles of form, aesthetic, and content, energetics, are perceived as mutually conditioning each other. It is, secondly, a worldview which remains inherently conflictive, but which does not deny this potential for conflict, but on the contrary celebrates it as a source of creative energy. And it is thirdly a cosmovision in which the ever-shifting relation between both elements is perceived as absolutely necessary for human life to remain meaningfully possible. Greek tragedy in turn symbolized the celebration and symbolic expression of this complex system. Tragedy, far from being a mere form of amusement or focused solely on the theatrical plot in the foreground, was an affirmation of this matter of perceiving life, a statement, an affirmation of how to deal with the questions of form and content, thinking and living, or aesthetic and energy. In the art of tragedy, the aspects of both gods surface in great detail. The Apollonian, formal, aspect gives the tragedy its structure. It serves to channel the Dionysian energy. Quote, in the stagecraft of tragedy, both are united. Through Apollonian form, the pure Dionysian energy attains a place, frame, plot, and style of communication. Nietzsche admires the art of tragedy as fusion of those two aspects. For what is at stake in the art of the transpersonal self, it is important to realize that Nietzsche furthermore renders this tragic Apollonian as the principle of individuation according to stylistic and aesthetic criteria. Through the Apollonian structure, the subject can achieve individuality, separate form, and distinctness. In Greek tragedy, the Apollonian is thus symbolized through the single, individual figure, the tragic hero. Towards the end of his creative life, Nietzsche would come back to the Apollonian and describe it the following way. The word Apollonian means the urge to perfect self-sufficiency. To the typical individual, to all that simplifies, distinguishes, makes strong, clear, unambiguous, typical, freedom under the law. the Apollonian soul turns into the principle of individuation, the principium individuationis, which makes for individual identity and stability. The Dionysian, on the contrary, is expressed on stage through the dithyrambic chorus. This chorus, as a source of tragic music, pulls the spectator into another direction. The chorus on stage is a collective that is singing together. Its music defies individuality and compels the audience towards a letting go, towards losing and dissolving individuality in the wild effects of the music. The Dionysian stands for the collective element, in which all individuality is dissolved in an energetic flow. Quote, the word Dionysian means an urge to unity, a reaching out beyond personality, the everyday society, reality, across the abyss of transitoriness, a passionate, painful overflowing into darker, fuller, more floating states, an ecstatic affirmation of the total character of life, and that which remains the same, just as powerful, just as blissful, through all change. The great pantheistic sharing of joy and sorrow that sanctifies and calls good even the most terrible and questionable qualities of life, the eternal will to procreation, to fruitfulness, to recurrence, the feeling of the necessary unity of creation and destruction. The Apollonian soothes, calms, and heals, but also asserts and fortifies individuality and structure, whereas the Dionysian is the perpetual call to let go and give in, to lose inhibitions and move from the rational level towards that which is not known but felt, vibrating through every pore and is thus experienced. Gilles Deleuze provides us with an image of this intricate connection between the Apollonian form and the Dionysian content. Dionysus is like the background on which Apollo embroiders beautiful appearances, but beneath Apollo, Dionysius rumbles. Only on the background of the Dionysian content, the Apollonian forms of individuality become possible. Simultaneously, the Dionysian pull towards disindividuation is necessary for Apollonian individual being to give way to a new becoming. Life then turns into an always precarious balancing act between the two principles. It is a taking into account and respecting both elements of life in their interplay and conflictivity. In this balancing act, Nietzsche situates Greece not just geographically, at the border between two places, which show the extreme prevalence of either the Apollonian and the Dionysian, Rome and India. Quote, but from orgies, a people can take one path only, the path to Indian Buddhism. And in order that this may be endurable at all with its yearnings towards nothing, it requires the rare ecstatic states with their elevation above space, time, and the individual. Where the political drives are taken to be absolutely valid, it is just as necessary that the people should go to the path of the most extreme secularization, whose most magnificent but also most terrifying expression may be found in the Roman Imperium, placed between India and Rome and pushed toward a seductive choice, the Greeks succeeded in inventing a third form. In the negotiation between those two principles, between the formalizing individuation of the Apollonian and the energetic flow of the Dionysian revelries, the art of Greek life took place. To sum it up, the Apollonian Dionysian traverses the field of tragedy and gives it meaning within a larger context. The corresponding cosmovision is characterized through its striving for an always precarious balance between the principles of form and content, or aesthetic and energetic, and the acknowledgement of conflict as potentially creative, but in any case inevitable force in human life. This provides an understanding of the relation between two of our three elements, the Dionysian Apollonian and the fields of art via tragedy. Before we can complete this first part of the theoretical discussions and draw some conclusions, it will now be necessary to take a look at the third element of relevance in the birth of Greek tragedy, the Socratic-Platonic moment. 1.2. The Apollonian hegemony. The Socratic-Platonic moment heralds the point of rupture within the Greek cosmovision, the instant when the balance between the two principles was to be fatefully upset. With the appearance of Socrates and Plato, the scales were tipped in one direction and ultimately proved to be beyond the possibility of regaining a balance. Nietzsche, in this instance, focuses on Socrates, but his disciple Plato will deserve equal attention here. With Nietzsche, we will so take a look at the changes occurring in the 5th century BC around Socrates and Greek tragedy, before approximating Plato and the Apollonian hegemony. In the 5th century BC, the art form of Greek tragedy dies away and is replaced by a new form of theatrical art, new Attic comedy, as introduced by Euripides. In its wake, the protagonist and structure of the story gain more importance, while the chorus and music are subsequently relegated to the backseat. Theater increasingly starts to follow a narrative for which the energetic elements play an ever smaller role. In the overall realm of the arts, Apollonian elements achieve new heights. Doric architecture, the clear and simple lines of this most Apollonian art form, reaches its maturity at this time. Nietzsche comments that there is a war being waged to push back the Dionysian elements. The Doric state and Doric heart are explicable only as a permanent military encampment of the Apollonian. For Nietzsche, Socrates, together with Euripides, is the first person to no longer comprehend tragedy, to no longer grasp its emotional and energetic Dionysian pull. Socrates, the theoretical man, approaches the arts from a rational point of view. Quote, Socrates might be called the typical non-mystic, in whom, through a hypertrophy, the logical nature is developed as excessively as the instinctive nature is developed in the mystic. For all Socrates' rational and intellectual capabilities, this intuitive element necessary to perceive the Dionysian is increasingly undernourished in the post-Socratic world. In Nietzsche's work, Socrates stands for the archetype of all thinkers who wish to master life through rational thought. Looking for structure, speech, and aesthetics, the Dionysian element is downplayed. Socrates himself famously commented that he was unable to play a musical instrument. Once more, in the words of Nietzsche, this is the new opposition, the Dionysian and the Socratic, and the art of Greek tragedy was wrecked on this. Greek tragedy has been, as I have pointed out in the previous section, more than just a form of theatrical amusement. It had been the expression and celebration of a cosmovision. The shift that occurred when tragedy started to wither might have been imperceptible at first, but it would turn out, as we shall see, to be a fundamental break in Western history. Nietzsche in his account focuses on Socrates, but for the purpose of this work, it is necessary to follow the turn of events for a little longer and also take Socrates' most famous disciple into account. For while it can be agreed with Nietzsche that in Socrates theoretical man had found its origin, it was Plato who would begin to formalize this new way of thinking which we will take a look at in the second chapter. The foremost principle for this new way of life, the founding ground for a new cosmovision, turned out to be a new category: the truth. The notion of truth at this time did not constitute a new phenomenon. However, it would become Plato's lasting influence to have taken this concept and filled it with a hitherto unknown meaning. Only with Plato does truth become what we perceive it today: the truth. In the Platonic understanding, the truth is attained by perceiving things as they really are, in the pure and abstract world of ideas, all things are revealed in their essence. What can be perceived with the senses in this world is mere appearance, the shadow and distorted version of this purity. Foucault remarks on Plato that he searched for the authentic, the pure gold. And he did so by taking a look at those impure manifestations in the real world, and then looking from above these manifestations to a model so pure that the actual purity of the pure resembles it, approximates it, and measures itself against it. Having the truth thus implies seeing things as they really are, in their ideal and abstract form. It thus provides a universal standard against which the merely apparent world of everyday existence is considered and has to pass muster. Gianni Vattimo sums up this Platonic invention of the truth, quote, "Plato's stable and definitive world of idea was supposed to guarantee the possibility of rigorous knowledge of the mobile, immutable things of everyday existence." With positing such a world of ideas, the truth itself becomes an abstract category, which in principle works the same and is valid everywhere and at all times. Through the history-making importance that is placed on the truth, the Apollonian elements of the formal, the abstract and universal, are favored. The truth can now become an abstract and formal universalism, and is thus an entirely Apollonian concept. Wolfgang Dietrich recasts the Nietzschean interpretation of the Apollonian Dionysian once more by associating these two principles explicitly with two tendencies on how to organize a society. The formal Apollonian becomes the moral worldview, and the content of the Dionysian an energetic interpretation of the world. The moral worldview ultimately recurs to an all-powerful outside creator God, who lays down the rules for humanity to follow. What derives from this is an interpretation of the world according to a formalized and universal code of conduct, moral, an absolute grid from which a division between good and evil can be derived, and which advances hand in hand with the formation of institutions as privileged places for interpretation. The energetic worldview, on the other hand, strives towards harmony in the universe, the harmony of society, nature, and cosmos. Harmony reigns when the relations in a concrete place and time are in order and balanced. The energetic worldview holds that everything is contained within everything else and aims for a harmonious sublation of dualities. The energetic is thus primarily a quality of relationality, whereas morality is derived from adherence to an externalized and abstract formal structure. Extrapolating this thought, it furthermore follows that the formal Apollonian worldview, as we have seen, also lends itself easily to universalization, whereas the Dionysian harmony remains local and contingent. With Plato and ever since in his wake, Apollo is given precedence over Dionysius, and with it the category of the formal rings within the Mediterranean and in the culture that derive from this region. Quote, with the transition to the concept of the one and only final truth, the Mediterranean turns away from all its neighbors, invents philosophy as an intellectual virtue, and Europe as a cultural project. With the Apollonian, the rational, the formal, and the aesthetic gain prevalence over the energetic, and with it triumphed the political, now understood as a formal and institutionalized category of societal organization. The first effects of this shift were so to be perceived exactly in the field of societal organization, with the institutional development of the city-state of the polis. The Dionysian fall from grace was fully corroborated later on with the beginning of Christianity, when Dionysius, as Satan, was relegated to the dark. The reign of Apollo, the reign of the principle of form, then came to bear fully in the institutionalizations of church, state, and later on in the formalistic methods of science. Finally, this led from the Socratic theoretical men to what Nietzsche calls white man's disease as the effect of the negation of Dionysian energy. The suppression of the energetic principle individually leads to blockages, and in its extreme forms, to anomie. The formalistic reign of Apollo leads to the attempt at controlling emotions via institutionalizations, and in its extreme forms to the fossilization and petrification experienced within the modern state system, and its ideas of tract diplomacy and conflict prevention. On the effects of this Apollonian hegemony, on a larger scale, Dietrich points out that it served to make Europe stubborn, self-referential, strong, and aggressive. On the outside, this led to centuries of the European expansionist drive of conquest and colonialism, which always went hand in hand with the Christian missionizing zeal, and on the inside, it meant the formalization and increasing aestheticization of politics and social life. Unhinged from the Dionysian, another element has since surfaced. The West, influenced by Apollo, has become phobic in its striving for security, its manic fear of the other, and absolute quest for control. The church and the state more and more became the guarantors of the Apollonian rule. Under the sign of institutionalization, and in the case of the church, absolute truth, a formalistic, abstract, an ultimately rational and universal worldview was aggressively spread all over the world. As Friedrich Nietzsche and later Wolfgang Dietrich already pointed out, church and morals also formally advanced hand in hand, as morality is derived from such a claim to the truth. Morals can then be defined as an abstract code of conduct, exclusively regulating and setting down the universal precepts for the good life. Through morals, it becomes possible to separate the good from the evil, the righteous from the sinners, just as through the good book, the believers can be separated from the pagans. Once the claim to ultimate truth and morals has been set down in principle, the others, those who do not follow this code of conduct, can at best be tolerated, but most of the time, they either have to be shown the right path towards alternatively salvation of their soul, the truth, development, progress, civilization, or enlightenment, or purged. As history has shown time and again, once the claim to the absolute truth is established, tolerance is always precarious and can only too easily give way to that other practice of conversion with fire and sword. In this rejection of otherness, another Apollonian element, the striving for purity, reaches its pinnacle. Those three figures, the claim to absolute truth, the rejection of the other, and simultaneous striving for purity, be that of the self and the own physical body, the purity of one's thoughts, of the social body or the race, are intricately connected. Their soul surfaces something extremely violent in an unchecked Apollonian striving for purity. Everything indeterminate, uncertain, everything in contradiction to the established rules, be that the rule of the law, the formal code of conduct of morals, but also everything that does not fit the preordained standards of normalcy, is constantly under the threat of aggression. It would take centuries for this formalization and aestheticization to be pushed to its extreme. At its culminating point, there nevertheless stands the civilization break whose shadows already led Walter Benjamin in the middle of the 1930s to his presentient realization. All efforts to aesthetize politics culminate in one point. That one point is war. In a reinterpretation of Benjamin's statement, one could agree that with Apollo rampant and unchecked, the Dionysian is ever more pushed to the margins. The complete formalization and aestheticization of the social and political sphere can ultimately only be hostile to life and become inhuman, and can so lead to the complete rejection and annihilation of the energetic force of life. The fascist regimes, from this point of view, are not the accidents of modernity but the culmination of its Apollonian tendencies. But even if we do not push the argument until its logical conclusion in the fascist extremes, there still is something deeply disconcerting about the modern nation-states and their large-scale statistical attempts at population management. The abstract and formal figures of birth rates, life expectancies, crime rates, literacy, and the subsequent measures leading to hospitals per capita, literacy campaigns, sanitation projects, education policies, reforms in penal law, all those attempts to call and optimize the abstract figure of a population according to predetermined statistical standards have been characterized by Michel Foucault as biopower. Biopower is the power that does not need to kill the other anymore, that does no longer regress to weapons and wars, but that still makes otherness disappear. Instead of resorting to direct physical violence, its aim is seemingly much more benign, aimed at improving population statistics. Those statistical aggregates, in turn, are inspired by pre-given standards of normalcy and ideal states to be reached, fostering a certain way of living. The consequence is that just as certain forms of life are furthered and approved, while others are disallowed, the effect also is that certain ways of living, and thus in the end, certain kinds of people ceased to exist. Behind the functioning of biopower, there is in each case an abstract, formal, scientific or moral universalism, or in other words, an Apollonian form. Using the terms of Gilles Deleuze and Félix Guattari, the Apollonian principle is the one of the stratified, that which segments or territorializes and ties the subject to the principle of identity. Its expressions, discourse, structure, syntax, pull us in a certain direction of individuation. In the famous words of Stuart Hall, they hail us into a particular place and so induce the investment into pre-established identity categories. It is only through this investment that those abstract categories are filled life. Letting oneself be hailed like this has, on the one hand, a stabilizing effect on identity. On the other hand, it is also petrifying and normalizing. Falling into the Apollonian trap, performing identities in line with those categories implies a discursive normalization of the subject according to pre-given social standards. The fortified Apollonian principle so favors being, stability, self-sameness, and is hostile to becoming, transformation, and change. But simultaneously, also a door is opened when one realizes, with Judith Butler, that if identity is performed, this implies that it can also be performed differently. It can be performed not only in accordance with social standards, but also in the disobedient way, resignifying those identity categories to which we are being hailed. Performing identity differently implies refusing the standards of normality, like, for example, when queering the boundaries of the white, North Atlantic, heterosexual ideal of gender identity. Michel Foucault points in a similar direction of resistance when stating that maybe the task today is not to discover what we are, but to refuse what we are. Those kinds of resistance, however, always run in the danger of entirely remaining within Apollonian categories. Insofar as becoming other always implies becoming somebody else, and the danger of re-ensnarement is so never far off. In the 70s, Foucault at first tried to circumnavigate this danger with the gesture of a permanent, unceasing refusal. Our task, then, would be the perpetual displacement of identity, the unceasing becoming other. This rejection is fueled by the very Foucauldian virtue of the critique of what has made us who we are in order to find out how we could yet be different. In his personal and professional life, Foucault unceasingly practiced this virtue by trying to efface his identity and rejecting all labels ascribed to him and trying to pin him to his identity. Structuralist, post-structuralist, Marxist, anti-psychiatrist. The body without organs, as conceptualized by Deleuze and Guattari, is yet another kind of resistance along similar lines, aimed against the normalizing discursive practice par excellence, the talking cure of Freudian psychoanalysis. The body without organs is pure resistance, a body devoid of organs. Deleuze and Guattari reason is pure surface, refusing the interiority which would make it an organism, something that is organized according to hierarchic arborescent principles. The body without organs so posits a barrier against the thrust of psychoanalysis, which is aimed at the interior of the human being and looks to decode the secrets that are inside. In the schizophrenic rejection of the bounded stable ego, in the refusal of all interiority, and in the rhizomatic exteriority of the thousand plateus, Deleuze and Guattari aim to scramble and disrupt the organizing power of the talking cure. The line of thinking we will follow here, while drawing upon those approaches, is different insofar as that what is aimed at is not so much a resistance to the Apollonian, but Verwendung of its hegemony. Total rejection of the Apollonian would imply, if ever possible, an attempt to establish a new truth and fall back into the violent suppression of the dynamic balance between Apollonian and Dionysian elements. Balancing the aesthetic, systemic Apollonian once more with the Dionysian would imply twisting the principle of individuation with an energetic practice. Thereby, a door could be opened to a positive understanding of becoming. What this would result in is a permanent practice of the Verwendung of individuality, in the sense of an integrating letting go. In the last phase of his work, Michel Foucault also seemed to arrive at a similar conclusion, when the preoccupation with resistance in his writings was successfully replaced by questions of a positive art of the self. It seems as if, at the end, the gesture of resisting who we are became wed to the problematic of how to still positively fashion one's life. For this heart of the self, Foucault, like Nietzsche before him, recurred to the ancient Mediterranean area. This will be the topic for the next chapter. 1.3 Conclusion. With this first Nietzschean chapter, several crucial insights for the theoretical frame have been attained. First, I have worked out the details of the aspects of the Apollonian and Dionysian and identified with form aesthetic and content energetic. Following Wolfgang Dietrich, in a first transposition, the Apollonian and Dionysian were likened to two cosmovisions, the moral and the energetic. This first transposition so started out with two deities, two divinities of ancient Greece, and then extrapolated certain principles. Secondly, an insight was gained into how different forms of relating those two principles play themselves out on the societal level, leaving for a moment aside the details of how this cosmovision was concretely lived. Thereof derives thirdly the requirement for the next chapter, for the completion of the theoretical framework, and before approaching the art of the transpersonal self properly, it will now be necessary to retake those findings from an individual perspective to determine their exact relevance for an art of living. I will do so with Michel Foucault. After a step of clarification in the third chapter, we shall then, in the fourth chapter, read him against the grain and relate his work differently. Fourthly, it has now become clearer what the immediate stakes for an art of the transpersonal self are. Relating the Apollonian once more with the Dionysian cannot be a rejection of the aesthetic component, and neither can it be the attempt to overcome everything that has made us who we are in the postmodern age. The art of the transpersonal self thus could only become possible as a form of acknowledging both the Apollonian and Dionysian components and of putting them into an affirmative relation once more towards an art of transforming ourselves. Fifthly, we are now in a position to formulate two overall qualifications for the attempt to create an art of the transpersonal self. The outcome would A, only be transpersonal if it would become possible to twist Verwendung, the clear-cut Apollonian individuation, which has led to the autonomous, self-grounding subject of modernity, with a Dionysian energetic, thereby fading of personal borders in an opening of the self, while perhaps still acknowledging and affirming the need for certain aesthetic, stylistic elements in our life. This art of the self would be transrational if the Socratic, Platonic rationality and cognition could once more be related to the energetic, and the drive to know and rationally grasp could be let fade away. The transrational could thus be found, to use the beautiful picture Friedrich Nietzsche draws here for us, in a Socrates who practices music. End of chapter 1.